Mrs. Merrifield. I can't easily find a good word to say for Mrs. Merrifield. Born in 1907, the daughter of a coal miner in Wigan, she married an iron worker in 1931 and lived an apparently blameless life for the next 12 years. During the war, she had her first brush with the law and was convicted of illegally possessing 3 ration books, a relatively minor way of swindling government in the time of hoarding and black marketeering. Possibly so, but the authorities took it quite seriously. Louisa Ellison, as she then was, served a prison sentence for the offence. Perhaps the courts felt that one extra ration book might be put down to impulsive temptation, but 2 meant culpable criminality. Or perhaps they just didn't like her manner. In 1947, the welfare services paid attention to Louisa. They found her unfit to look after her 3 children, one of whom was still a baby, and they were taken into the council's care and protection. 2 years later, her husband Joe Ellison died so suddenly and surprisingly that a post-mortem was carried out. But this established that he perished from natural causes, his liver being diseased. Louisa is officially off the hook of being suspected of murder thus early in her career. Within 3 months, she had married again. Her second husband was a retired mine manager, 80 years old. Within another 3 months, he had died, and with him his pension. Perhaps one should feel a degree of sympathy for Louisa, an unattractive 40-year-old with no skills in a society which took it for granted that a male breadwinner was the proper means of support for a woman. Within 6 months, she had found her third husband, 69-year-old Alfred Merrifield. This rather vague old widower had 10 children and very little money. His old age pension and a little help from the National Assistance Board was all he could offer Louisa. Odd caretaking and domestic jobs did little to supplement this meagre income, and the couple were quick to respond to an advertisement offering free accommodation in Blackpool to anyone who would look after an elderly widow. Mrs. Sarah Ricketts was 79. She had been married before twice. Both husbands had committed suicide. Her married daughters were only able to visit her occasionally. Her bungalow in Devonshire Road had room for a live-in housekeeper companion, and the Merrifields moved in on March the 12th. On April the 14th, Mrs. Ricketts died. But this did not mean Mrs. Merrifield's hopes of a new financial security were dashed. Quite the reverse. She was enjoying a new and extraordinary prosperity, which she had predicted as though it were fait accompli as early as March the 26th. On that day, she told her old friend Mavis Brindley, "I've had a bit of good luck. Where we're living, an old lady's died and left me her bungalow." Mrs. Ricketts had not died at that time. She had, however, on March the 24th, given her solicitor instructions to draw up a new will, leaving Mrs. Merrifield the bungalow. Obviously, the new housekeeper had made a very favourable impression. Her husband quickly caught up with her, as in a few days the will was amended to make the Merrifields joint beneficiaries. On March the 31st, it was signed. A little over a week later, Mrs. Merrifield evidently suffered doubts as to whether such a sudden bequest to a new acquaintance might not have been taken as evidence that the old lady's mind had deteriorated. She went to see Dr. Burton Yule and asked him to examine Mrs. Ricketts. She explained about the will, and saying that she didn't want any trouble with the relatives, asked for a certificate that the old lady was compos mentis. Dr. Yule found a perfectly healthy woman of almost 80 who was extremely surprised to see him. Mrs. Merrifield had not warned her employer of the step she was taking to ensure her legacy. 4 days later, Mrs. Merrifield went again to Dr. Yule's surgery to pay his bill. She did not ask him to call round again, and she said nothing about Mrs. Ricketts' state of health. Yet that same day, she visited another doctor, Albert Victor Wood, and asked him to call in Devonshire Road, as Mrs. Ricketts was seriously ill and, she said, had been for some time. Dr. Wood had visited the old lady 3 years previously, when he found that apart from a mild bronchitis, she was in good health for her age. He found exactly the same condition on April the 13th, 1953. Indeed, on that day, Mrs. Ricketts was quite well enough to answer the door herself while Mrs. Merrifield was out. The caller was George Forgeon, with a bottle of brandy ordered from a wine merchant. Mrs. Ricketts liked her regular nips. Forgeon was used to delivering a bottle of rum every week, a dozen bottles of Guinness every month, and a bottle of brandy every 3 months or so. But on this occasion, Mrs. Ricketts was unable to pay him. "I don't know what they are doing with my money," she told the driver. Mr. Merrifield offered to go to the bank and find out how much was in her account. And Forgeon then heard what he would not have recognised at the time as a decisive snub. "While you're out, you can go to the solicitors as well," she said. "I want to change my will." Forgeon was left in no doubt about her opinion of the Merrifields when she turned back to him and said, "They're no good to me. They'll have to go." The prospect of secure home ownership had been dangled in front of the Merrifields, only to be evaporating before their eyes. Most of us would have been unsurprised. Any old person who makes a new will in favour of an acquaintance of only 12 days' standing is pretty clearly likely to tinker habitually with the disposition of their estate. Most of us would discount such a legacy as fairy gold, likely to be withdrawn on a whim, or at best to be substantially reduced in legal costs as the changing bequests encourage other potential heirs to contest the will. But the Merrifields were both described as stupid. Louisa had told two people in the previous 2 days that Mrs. Ricketts' death was imminent or had happened. On the 11th of April, she told Mrs. Jessie Worley, "We're landed. I went to live with an old lady and she died and she's left me a bungalow worth £4,000. And on the 12th, she told Mrs. Veronica King that she had to go and lay the old lady out. Mrs. King, surprised, asked if Mrs. Ricketts was dead and received the astonishing reply, "Not yet, but she soon will be." At midday on April the 14th, Dr. Wood's partner responded to an urgent summons from Mrs. Merrifield at midday. He found Mrs. Ricketts very ill indeed. 2 hours later, she was dead. Naturally, Dr. Wood and his partner refused to issue a death certificate. They'd found Mrs. Ricketts mildly bronchial the day before. Nor would Dr. Yule oblige. He had accepted a firm invitation to find Mrs. Ricketts healthy only 5 days previously. Nevertheless, Mrs. Merrifield tried to make arrangements to have the old lady cremated as soon as possible. A post-mortem revealed that Mrs. Ricketts was full of the rat poison rhodine, which she had apparently taken during the night of April the 13th to 14th. Two questions had to be answered before the Merrifields could be charged with her murder. Where had the rhodine come from? There was no trace of any in the house. And how had she been persuaded to consume it? It tastes and smells vile. Solid police inquiries answered the first question. A chemist's assistant in Manchester remembered selling a tin of rhodine to an elderly man with a hearing aid accompanied by a woman. She positively identified Mr. Merrifield as the man, though she could not be certain about Mrs. Merrifield as the woman. And forensic scientists carried out a sequence of unpleasant tests with phosphorus, the active constituent of rhodine. They mixed it with various foods and drinks, took it in their mouths to taste, and spat it out. The result of this culinary experimentation was the conclusion that rhodine could easily be administered in blackcurrant jam or rum. And Mrs. Ricketts regularly ordered a bottle of rum every week. A dirty spoon in an old handbag, where Mrs. Merrifield had been hiding insurance policies from her husband, was coated with a gritty substance which, on analysis, might have been rhodine mixed with rum. And so the Merrifields went to trial. The different impressions they made in the witness box determined their different fates. It was clear enough that the old lady had been poisoned somehow. A defence expert's attempt to submit that she coincidentally died of necrosis of the liver shortly after swallowing phosphorus, but before it had time to act on her, did little to help the defendants. There was no doubt that the phosphorus had been swallowed. And the expert's vague contention that there were a lot of rats in breweries and some rat poison might somehow have contaminated a bottle from which the old lady drank her beer led the Attorney General to remark sarcastically that she might have been struck by lightning. And the judge commented that a dying rat might have got in through the window, though it would be up to the jury to decide how it had got into Mrs. Ricketts' throat. Mrs. Merrifield proved herself in the witness box. A vulgar and stupid woman with a dirty mind. Again, I'm quoting the judge. She claimed that Mrs. Ricketts had got up and collapsed in the middle of the night of the 13th, and when helped back to bed had put out her tongue as a request for a drink. So she had given her an egg cup of brandy or rum, which the old lady had prepared for herself before retiring. That was the extent of either defendant's attempts to account for the old lady ingesting poison. Asked why she had not sent for a doctor at once, Mrs. Merrifield replied that 3:15 is not a nice time in the morning to go out on the streets. Confronted with the strange prophetic remarks about the old lady's death that she'd made, Mrs. Merrifield produced the explanation that the witnesses were just jealous of her because they were all up to their necks in mortgages. This was indeed very vulgar and very stupid. Accusations that other people are jealous almost always indicate a normally envious frame of mind on the part of the accuser. People without a covetous or envious disposition themselves are not prone to imagine that others will be motivated by envy. And when the Attorney General asked whether she did not fear that Mrs. Ricketts' will might have been changed yet again, cutting her out and leaving the entire bequest to her husband, Mrs. Merrifield produced the astonishing suggestion that there might have been some liaison between Mr. Merrifield and Mrs. Ricketts. "Everyone has their suspicions," she said, evincing more vulgarity and stupidity. She was very fond of him. "I found Mrs. Ricketts a very immoral woman, but I realised she was a human being and had had no husband for 8 or 10 years." When his turn came to give evidence, Mr. Merrifield rejected the accusation forcefully. "A more infamous statement has never been made in a court of justice," he cried. "It is definitely not true. Fancy an old woman of 80 paralysed down one side. It's outrageous. Look at my wife, a young woman. Fancy me getting into bed with an old woman of 80. Not a very nice pair, the Merrifields. Alfred being more offended by the outrageous imputation against his own sexual taste than by the vile slur on Mrs. Ricketts' morals. He consistently thought of himself first. When he was asked why he didn't get up to help with Mrs. Ricketts during the night, he complained, "I'm a cripple. It's definite that I should have me rest. There was a capable lady there, my wife, to attend to her." But by his own account, Mrs. Ricketts' case was worse than his own. He thought she was very small and feeble, and said that she'd had a stroke in the right arm and leg and had both arms wrapped up in cotton wool and bandages. He didn't entirely approve of her, as, like his wife, he thought that she was a very heavy drinker for an old lady. Of course, a bottle of rum a week and a dozen of Guinness a month is more than most of us keep in the house, but the old lady could not get out to pubs. And while I can't personally afford to drink at that rate, I should hardly consider myself alcoholic if I did. Mr. Merrifield was quite definite about the purchase of the Rodine in Manchester. "It was all perjured evidence got up by Scotland Yard," he shouted, banging his fist on the table. But he had a softer moment in the dock when his counsel opened the defence. He burst into tears, saying, "I cannot stick this. It's not fair. Let me go down until they've finished this." I agree with the jury about him. A nasty, selfish old man, but it seems impossible to say whether he was a murderer. They found Louisa guilty, but could not reach agreement about Alfred. Mrs. Merrifield was hanged to the accompaniment of surprisingly little protest about a woman going to the gallows. The authorities decided against putting Mr. Merrifield on trial again. and after 74 landladies had positively refused to have him in their houses, he bought a caravan, where he lived until his death in 1962.